everyone. Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is a show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Sharday Sellers. On today's episode, we have an interview with the hilarious creators of Cartoon Network's comedy series, Teenage Euthanasia, Alyson Levy and Alissa Nutting. Alyson, Alissa, and I chat about writing animated comedies, knowing when you've gone too far, working with your best friend, and more. Check it out.
We've talked about this before, but for the people who are listening who don't know, how did you meet Alissa? How did you two connect and become not just only friends, but like co-writers?
Well, I do feel like it was real kismet because I'd worked with lots of people, but I feel like my collaboration with Alissa is like just cosmically, you know, christened perfectly for our sort of creative needs. But it sort of came from me being a TV person and making a lot of cult shows at Adult Swim, and but really wanting to make some with women show creators, which, you know, this was, you know, the whatever, people still want to do that, but it was kind of a while ago. And then I read one of her books, her book of short stories, and I just felt like, oh my God, this is this woman I've been looking for, this other weird woman. And she also was, you know, once we got connected, was really into Adult Swim. She was really into wanting to make an animated show, which is kind of a real niche within a niche. And so, yeah, that, and then we just worked like remotely. We've never lived in the same place, but we have a really good work flow of sort of, you know, her being a night owl and me being an early bird. And the owl.
Wait, Alissa, what's the name of the book?
Oh, that collection was called Unclean Jobs for Women and Girls.
Ooh, okay. And where can we get it? Just so anyone listening can look it up.
That's from Echo Books. You can order it through your independent bookstore, or you can get it from any of the evil corporate overlords that conveniently bring it to you the next day.
Yes, we won't judge you guys. Just get the book and read it.
Yeah.
I don't know. What was your first recollection of meeting Alyson or hearing from Alyson? Do you remember what that was like?
Oh, it was so interesting because I actually, even before we sort of like hooked up work-wise, I did get to have kind of like this very brief meeting with her in New York. And it was like very informal. It wasn't about like working. We were just like at the park, you know, with children. And I had just had a baby. And I remember like there just like wasn't anyone who I just remember how kind she was. Like when you're a new mom, like all these disgusting things are happening, you know, to like your body. Even like I just remember how kind and open and like funny she was with that. And I just like had this sense, you know, that like I somehow already knew and loved this person and could trust her with anything. I mean, it was just sort of like it was great. So then when she reached out about something creative, I really lost my mind, you know, with happiness.
Alyson, I want to ask, and then I want to ask you the same question, Alissa. For our audience who's listening, these are either inspiring writers or current writers, maybe people who've never written with a partner before. But what do you think is the three most important things, not only for a writing partnership, but for a friendship? Because that's how it started, right? Like, I don't think you guys would be writing partners if you weren't friends.
I mean, yeah. I think for us, it did sort of come out of the writing first, and then we've become mm-hmm. friends. Like, we got along right away, but I guess the three things, like for me, like I'm really into people being dependable. So if like you say you're going to like rework something and then you don't, I find that to be pretty annoying. And if Alissa is like flaking on something, she'll be like, I'm flaking on this, but you'll have it in like 3 hours. And then she'll have it in those 3 hours. I find, you know, I'm kind of a producer under everything. So like that is a big thing for me.
That and sounds like trust and communication in one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I'd say another one is like for us, especially is like and other things, shared sense of humor. Because that you just can't work on. Like if you don't share a sense of humor, like it just, there's not, just find someone who does, you know, there's lots of different kinds of senses of humor. And that's when I read the book and got very excited, even for like people out there. If like, oftentimes if we're trying to like quickly get that, it's like, we'll look at someone's Twitter or something and be like, okay, this person like will get our sense of humor or we get theirs or something. It's a quick, you know, pretty fast
Hear that, people? They're checking your Twitters. They are checking your Twitters. So watch your P's and Q's.
I don't know. I guess the other one is just like not getting angry. Oh, no, I know the better one. Mm-hmm. Like not saying no all the time to every single thing you say. I've worked with people like that. And just everything you say, it's either no, or they have to turn it into their idea somehow within their own head. It then has to completely filter through their own thing. And I hope I'm not like that. But yeah, I think maybe I'm a little guilty of that. But either way, Alyssa is not like that at all.
No, that's a good one, because that also goes down to like ego. Like, can you accept an idea that's not yours and then just be supportive that it's actually good and it didn't come from your brain? Like that, I run into that a lot. So that's an important one. Alyssa, what would you say your top three?
Yeah, I mean, kind of in a related way. I mean, I think like the first one is, you know, the first one for me is kind of goes along with, you know, ego. And I don't sort of know, I'm sure there's like a perfect, you know, like German term, you know, for it, or like, you know, a Japanese word that embodies, you know, like the entire essence of what I want to say, but just kind of like not being, like being able to have your idea kind of, you know, tested, or, you know, to have like, to be able to accept the other person saying like, I don't like that, you know, or to, like, if I can't be honest with someone, I think like that is a huge deal breaker for me. You know, it's like, I have to be able to say to you, like, I don't like that, you know, or like, that doesn't make sense to me, or that doesn't work for me, and know that like, you're not going to fall apart.
Yes.
Ego wise, you know, and I'm not judging at all people who do, you know, and I will absolutely not pretend that I, you know, was just that I like came out of the womb, you know, with the ability to handle criticism. I, you know, like I did a fiction MFA program after my first workshop, you know, where like you submit a story and like, you know, everyone in the class talks about your story. After my first graduate workshop, I had to go to the bathroom, like on break, and cry, you know, like in a stall, you know, and then I got myself together and I went back to class. Like it is an arm I had to build, and it is an armor you can build and a skill set that you can acquire. So I also like do want to encourage people, you know, like if you're kind of out there and you haven't put yourself in those situations, like it is a muscle you can build. But now for me, part of the reason like working is so fun is because like, to me, like on TV shows, it's just triage, you know, like I just want the best idea, you know, like we're right. Just like working to fix the patient and like make it as amazing as possible. And it doesn't matter, you know, where the idea is coming from at all. So I've done a lot of work to be that person, you know, and I require that. Absolutely. In a partner that I can just be direct with you and I don't have to, you know, like do some kind of compliment sandwich, you know, of like,
yes, you know, the very like, woman compliment sandwich. So we're like,
opening, it's so dark. Great. Yeah. I just like, I love this line. And I want to talk a little bit about, I don't want to do that. There's no time for that. You can be so much more productive, you know, if you're just like able to talk to somebody and be like, no, no, no. Oh, you know, like that I kind of like, let's talk about that. And I think Alyson and I are both able to do that. Like that's the biggest thing for me and the biggest block I've had, you know, attempting to write with men.
Bless you.
Excuse me.
Sorry. It's going around.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of like the whole thing for me. And then of course, yes, you need to have like the same, I think you have to live in the same reality of the show, you know, like if you are seeing two different ideas, you know, for tone or, you know, feeling or vision, you know, like it's like, that's just not going to work. You know, you have to be like working on the same show conceptually with your partner. And then, you know, I, at this point, as you know, like as a woman of age in the entertainment industry, you know, like definitely have a no asshole policy, you know, and I really want to differentiate being an asshole from being direct, from being assertive, you know, from being to the point, from not, you know, emotionally caretaking or handholding, yes. You know, that's not being an asshole. You know, like women are often criticized for taking on those like very normal, you know, productive business traits, you know, but assholeness, no, I'm not going to do it.
I sent my best friend a meme on Instagram I saw, and it was a cartoon of two people in the office. And the first person says, "Hey, what's the difference between being assertive and being an asshole?" And the second person said, "Your gender." Said, oh my God. And I was like,
no lies detected.
Lies detected. But speaking of, you know, woman of age, which is what, over 22, over 18?
Correct. Yes, I'm 23. Yes.
Yes, exactly. Alyson, let's talk about Teenage Euthanasia. Season 2, first of all, congratulations to you guys. That is not easy. First of all, it's not easy to sell a show. It's not easy to get a pilot. It's not easy to finish season 1. And it damn sure isn't easy to be almost done with the season 2. So kudos and congratulations all of that long. But the reason why I was really excited to do this episode is because when I watched the show, I felt little 13-year-old me who was watching Daria in the late 90s, early aughts, was like, finally, a show again about me. Like Daria, after that, I didn't see anything else after that. So Alyson, for you going into this show, what did your younger Alyson self like kind of pull and put in here as an adult? Like, okay, we didn't get to do this as a kid, but now I'm going to address this as a creator.
Yeah, I think for me, one of the things that I was really excited to do is just to have like really weird female characters that kind of got to be in control both behind the scenes and on camera. I feel like there's a lot of really funny women that have made really great shows, and there's a lot of really weird men who've got to make a lot of their weird shows. And as a person to the side of a lot of the weird male, I was very excited to do this. And I'd been trying to do this for about 10 years before I did. So, you know, with lots of different tries and fails and efforts. That was, I don't know if it was something as a kid I thought of, but it was definitely from like my 20s on that I really was trying to figure out how to make it real.
But what's your definition of weird? Because I feel like I watch this show and it's normal to me. I'm just humor. This is my brand. This makes sense. This makes sense. But other people watch and go, "What are you watching?" I'm like,
I think it's just like there's a huge tradition of like outsider-y male creators, especially on Adult Swim, which where I had been, but even back to like filmmaking as well, just sort of indie. I'm like an indie person. I'm not like a mainstream Hollywood kind of person, or that's not what interests me. But so I just had felt like there just hadn't been that many chances. There wasn't that many people giving, you know, even Daria as a male show creator. So I just felt like, you know, I don't know. I just believed so strongly that there was so many ideas that just hadn't gotten done. There hadn't been like a women's Aqua Teen Hunger Force or whatever it's going to be. Like there still hasn't been very many, and there's still a lot of room for it. But I felt like, I don't know. What makes it different? I think is just the like level of imagination that you're sort of allowed to do in storytelling. And I don't know, I feel like a lot of times probably women need to feel like they have to play it kind of safe to even get something more made. And I literally cannot do that. I don't know how to do that. And I don't have ideas like that. So
yes.
Yeah.
The amount of times I've gotten in trouble for my weird off-brand humor, and I'm like apologizing to people for it. And then you see a show like this, you're like, okay, it's not just me. You guys are freaks too. Thank you. So for Alyssa, for you, first of all, the title already is like Teenage Euthanasia. Like, where did that come from? And like, why land there to go, this is the perfect title to encompass this show?
Yeah. I mean, I think just kind of like as a, you know, as someone who spent a lot of her, you know, kind of like middle and high school years specifically, you know, wishing to be put out of her misery in a humane way. I just kind of like, it was always this like internal joke to me, you know, that like euthanasia would be like the perfect name, you know, for sort of like this like outsider teen who's not, you know, sort of like accepted by the main stream. And then I was also thinking, you know, about how like if a mother named, you know, like what would make a mother name a child, you know, like euthanasia. And I was thinking of like a teen mom, you know, who didn't want to have just, you know, had a baby and like wanted to be put out of her misery because she wanted to avoid motherhood altogether. And sort of like those two things, I don't know. I just love when, you know, when people sort of like haven't heard about the show and ask me about it, you know, I'm just like, well, it's called Teenage Euthanasia. It's about a teenager named Euthanasia. And that says to me, like to me, that really conveys, you know, something like essential about the show. Like I can go on, you know, and obviously like there's a lot more to say about it, you know, and it's in a funeral home and it has these, you know, three other great characters. And there's this, you know, mother who committed suicide and gets reanimated to have the second chance with her daughter. You know, but I think like all of that to me is kind of like encapsulated within this concept that like sometimes life is so painful, you just want to leave.
Yeah. Lobotomy. Mine would be teenage lobotomy. I'm here, but I don't want to really know what's happening. Just like, let me go. But Alyson, I'm curious, like with Alyssa explaining that, I have to know, was that the pitch you used in the room? Like,
I think it wasn't the perfect name because it's caused problems, you know, along the way, but it was perfect for us because I think it, you know, again, the show deals with death very directly. Mm-hmm. It's in that character. One of the other characters committed suicide. She's reanimated, brought from the dead. And the whole thing takes place in a funeral home. Mm-hmm. Like we are the most death positive show around. So I think like, but is that a popular concept? Just do people sometimes take a step back when I say that's the name of my show? Or am I hesitant to say it in certain environments? Mm-hmm. Yes to all of those questions. But I think, I don't know, it somehow positions it in the right way. And Adult Swim did have a moment. Right before
that's
we premiered.
So funny. Because I've seen a lot of Adult Swim shows.
They were very nervous. Okay. But it was literally like way too late. Like we were like about to premiere. And I was like,
No, it's going to work. It's going to work. Trust me. Well, Alyson, you know, speaking of which, you premiered, you saw the response to it. What was that first season like of just interacting with, or maybe not even interacting with audience, but just seeing everyone's reaction? Like, okay, they got it. Oh, good. Okay, good. Right?
I mean, it was hard to know, like, because it was still the pandemic. Like, you know, it was a very weird premiere. We did like a virtual San Diego Comic-Con. Like, you know, it was just like, but I mean, and we weren't even on, I'm not barely online and we weren't as much then. So it was very hard to know what anyone thought of it at all. And I think we were just kind of lucky that the network was just, they were immediately very pro the show and making another one kind of right away. And so that was an important feeling of support, probably the most. But then, I mean, you would just sort of randomly encounter people that had heard of it, and all the actors that were in it liked it. That was the other thing. It was like, we heard a lot from them, but no, we didn't have that much interaction with anyone else.
Well, Alyssa, speaking of the actors, I'm really curious because as someone who also moonlights as an actor, like they get the script in hand and sometimes you read things, you're like, oh, okay, you want me, I'm saying this, we're doing this. What are conversations with actors like who are a little bit like maybe conservative on that front? Like, I don't know if I can say this. I don't know if I can do that. Like, how do you ease their like nerves?
I mean, we are sort of self-selective in that I think that like the actors that we are drawn to, you know, are a lot of times, you know, either like comedians or actors who even sort of, you know, mainstream actors, like, you know, who were on the show this season, like, you know, Kieran Culkin or, you know, Paul Giamatti or J. Smith Cameron or Sophia Bush or Rachel Sennett, you know, like a lot of times I think you don't sort of like get to let your freak flag fly. And we have been really lucky in the sense that every, you know, actor, Alyson, jump in if you can like think of one that did have, you know, like an issue, but you know, every actor is usually so game. Yeah. And it's just like so fucking excited. Or excuse me.
You can curse. I fuck all the time.
Yeah. It's just so excited, you know, because they're like, I get to say that, you know, it's like finally, you know, like, oh, I get to be an anthropomorphized, you know, crotch beetle who's like, you know, searching for her dream. Like, let's do this. So they're usually really, really game. And I've got to say, like, our core actors, you know, which we're just so immensely lucky, you know, to have, like, Joe Firestone, it's Euthanasia or Annie, Maria Bamford's Trophy, Tim Robinson is Uncle Pete, and Bebe Neuwirth is Baba. And they all, I mean, it's a complete collaboration between us and the character. You know, they know these characters. You know, Bebe Neuwirth especially tells us when we got it wrong and, you know, corrects it with a better idea. And she's always right. I mean, she's a consummate professional, you know. I mean, she treats everything she does, you know, with like the commitment level of Shakespeare, you know, of doing Shakespeare. And it's just like amazing, you know, to have that brought to a scene where like her character has prehensile breasts, you know, that she's beating up a bear with, you know, like it's really great to have someone like take, you know, like your creative work at like, you know, a Hamlet level of seriousness. You know, for that, it's just like so absolutely wonderful. And I think all of those core actors, but also our guest actors, really understand, you know, the link between like humor as a coping mechanism, you know, and you know, pain and like depression, and you know, we're all drawn to things that make us outrageously laugh, you know, probably for that specific reason. So we're just so lucky that they really, you know, not only get the show and get the characters, but you know, they seem to just sort of like unleash themselves, you know, and like lean into the trauma of the show
and open up, right?
And in a cathartic comedic way.
Which is really hard, because this is the type of show, like you said, death is not an easy subject for, I think, 99.9% of the population to talk about. So Alyson, in the writer's room, what is the balance between, okay, we're having a good time and it's really funny, and then, oh, now we're releasing all our trauma, our fears and our nightmares, and we're crying as well. Cause I'm a crier. I'm going to cry regardless.
I'm trying to think. We didn't have so many tears. We had a lot, mostly comedy people, you know, real comedy pros in there with us. And it's like almost more like, okay, let's like, I, you know, there's no idea that's kind of too like bad or too like outside. Like, we'll always try to figure out how it could work. So people, I think, would sort of try to outdo each other in terms of like, well, I've been in a million rooms and I could never pitch the, you know, foreskin reattachment movement pitch, or the, you know, mob limousine pitch I've always wanted to do, or like whatever it was, you know, we're sort of, you know, or I remember, you know, the tear taster. You know, like, I mean, what very few
sommelier,
a tier sommelier pitch, which people might be like, yeah, that's Jordan Temple, but know, and then make that into something. But like, okay, yeah. we'll be like, okay, that's really interesting, you know, like let's see where that goes. So we don't really shut anything down, but we definitely don't require anyone to open up about anything. And you know, that's just sort of maybe our own particular way. But yeah, it's like more just like a lot of weird ideas. And then sometimes think like, I think the one, the jigsaw one about shopping,
yeah,
trauma, like shopping, like with your mother, like a lot of people had some, like that probably came from like a real personal place of story. Every woman has those.
Yes, like, we do. Nothing's scarier in the world than being in a fitting room with your mother and the pants are too tight. God bless you.
Amen. But
Alyson, on top of that, what do you think? Because people listening to this, they may be future showrunners, they may, or even just future EPs, leaders, producers in the room. What are the practices you want to bring into your room to make a safe space enough that you're not going to judge someone for a weird joke? Cause that's not the show, right? Like, yeah, if we did Grey's Anatomy, slow down, but this is the show where you can be weird. What kind of, I guess, room culture t- tips do you have that's important for you? I know every room is different, but like you mentioned, like you wanted to create a space where you can share, you cannot share. How do you do that though?
I think we ask people to come up with a lot of ideas. Mm-hmm. So we'd be like, come in tomorrow with like five, like short. We're not like going on and on and on with everybody IRL. We're like, come in with like five ideas. And we might say like, can you focus on anything with, let's all do stories that are, you know, Pete and Trophy together. Cause we want to like get something like that. So like, just come in and then, you know, as the list, so people are coming in with a lot. So they're not just like, oh, I love this one idea. I'm working on it for 2 days or, you know, it's like, it's very disposable. And that's a big thing for me. Like no idea is precious. Everything can change. Don't get hung up on one thing because it may not make it. You have to change for some reason that has nothing to do with you. You walk home and there's like a movie about that exact thing that's just coming out tomorrow, right. Like whatever it is. So
very relatable.
We're not very precious about it. And then it's kind of like any idea could work. So yeah. For us, that works perfectly. I don't know if that would work everywhere.
No, I mean, that creates it's like a communication, like a relationship we were talking about. Knowing, like, I think you said it, Alyssa, knowing that I can say something and I'm not going to be immediately punished for it. It may not be the best idea, but I'm not going to get a furrowed face or like, you're really disturbing. It's like, okay, it's not for us, but I'll see where you're going with this.
Right. I think judgment, you know, like I think judgment is really like a buzzkill in writing rooms, you know, and you can just kind of like tell. I mean, it's like really in like the air, you know, like when you walk into a space where you can just like smell the fear, you know, and you have like someone, you know, sort of like sitting there in this like very enforced hierarchy that is like shooting things down or making snide remarks, you know, or teasing people about, you know, things that they're coming up with, you know, like that is just like a really shitty imagination killing culture. You know, I mean, I think, you know, like we're really lucky in that we get to have a lot of fun, you know, sort of like brainstorming and talking about ideas and that like they are funny. But I mean, I think that does like also lend a lot to the environment, you know, of just knowing that like, oh, you know, I can throw something out there. I can tell a joke, you know, I can say this thing that like, I don't seriously believe in, but maybe we'll, you know, let somebody else, you know, kind of piggyback off it, you know, into an idea that could be like more, you know, practical to execute. Mm. You know, I think just like knowing that like, you're not going to be shamed.
Yes.
For what you say.
For being yourself. Which
goes a long way, doesn't it? Yeah.
The core of the show too. And I only have a couple of questions left because I know our time is wrapping up, but I want to say this and I'm going to go to you, Alyson. And I'm not saying this be a kiss ass. I've talked to you before, you know, this is how I feel about the show and I am emotional. I'm getting my period and there will be no excuses for what tears fall out my eyes. This show will save someone's life. I'm not being hyperbolic. This is the kind of show I wish I had growing up as a weird gothic in the closet girl in Michigan. And this is the type of show that I hope even, you know, women, young girls can watch and see themselves in. And I know they will. There's a, like, it may not be the most mass popular show out there, but there's that small little community that is going to maybe 20 years from now go, I used to watch Teenage Euthanasia and that saved my life. I know that for a fact. So Alyson, what is the most gratifying journey this show has brought you? That's a heavy question, I know, but like,
all right, well, I have teenage daughters. Yes. So, okay. So so one of them, this is just a little story from this week. One of them is her first week in ninth grade in her high school. And we have some merch. We have these sweatshirts, you know, that say consent in the Thrasher font. And then it says Teenage Euthanasia. So she wore it to school like the first week. And I was kind of like, okay. And she said this senior, so she's a freshman and a senior who, like she said, is like came in with like those giant Crocs and she has alopecia. So she has no hair and she's like 6 feet tall, like whatever. This girl is the only, like, looked to Sookie and was like, about her sweatshirt. And I was just like, and Sookie was like, told me that story. And I was like, these are our people, you know? Oh, and I have also, you know, had the pleasure of talking to like at other parent things, like therapists that see adolescents. And I said, oh yeah. And I'm hesitant to say the name. What do you do? Make the show. It's called Teenage Euthanasia. And then they're like, oh, I've heard about that from my patients. And I was like, that's our people. Like troubled teen is our demo. And like, I, it is very much, you know, why, you know, a lot of the stories, we do a lot of things to try to make the show not as grim as a sort of a way to make sure it does, you know, it doesn't always have a happy ending, but it always has a kind of resiliency to it that we are being, you know, is sort of meeting kids wherever they are.
Oh, I love that. And Alyssa, you're a mom too. I'm not sure.
How many? I have a 10-year-old daughter. Yes.
Wow. So what does the show mean to you and its like journey that you've been on?
I mean, you know, I think like also, and, you know, I mean, this is something that I was, you know, lucky too, to, you know, see in Alyson being modeled, you know, and something like that I aspire to myself. You know, I think like it's important for our daughters to see us doing this work, you know, like I think our daughters note that and, you know, feel proud of us, and they see us bringing, you know, like issues and representation to, you know, these kind of like female characters that aren't brought to every show. But, you know, I think for me, just like all of our characters on the show are outsiders. Yeah. They're not accepted, you know, they're not mainstream. They have something about them that makes them profoundly different, you know, from what society at large is telling them that they should be, you know, or look like, or, you know, want or feel like. And to me, that's so important to see represented as someone who's just felt like that all my life, and I'm sure I continue to.
Yeah. And since we last spoke, again, this is why I'm happy we were able to have this conversation. I found out my baby sister is having a baby girl. I'm going to be an auntie. And as exciting as, thank you. I know I did nothing to earn it, but it's my prize to claim. But as excited as that news was, as soon as she said it's a girl, I was overcome with, oh my God, there's just so much she's going to go through. And I want to show her things. Like, what if she grows up to be weird like me? This is a show. I could say, hey, let's sit down. We got this. You know, so thank you guys. Like, sincerely.
I think you have no idea how much that means to both of us to hear you say that, because that is why we make the show.
It's so important. And I hope the reason why shows like yours exist is so it sparks other people to get greenlit. Like, your show doing well means other people's shows like this will do well. And that's what we need. So before we wrap up, I'm going to ask one more emotional question, but it's a question we ask everyone on the show. And I'll start with Alyssa. What advice would you have for your younger writer self?
Ooh, okay. Well, I mean, first of all, I would say do not get married. You know, like I was very codependent. I mean, that's the thing, you know, you grow up not getting love, you want to go find it, you know, sometimes with, you know, men that can't give that to you.
Was it your writer? You tell your writer self this?
I would, because I would have had so much more time.
Yes.
Right. if I hadn't. But yeah, I mean, I would say, you know, don't be afraid to make it the center of your life. I think for a long time, I really like felt like I had to even pretend, you know, that I wanted so much less than I did, you know, because I was just like so scared of admitting it and failing. And I think like I would teach my younger writer self to define failure differently. Like what saves my life with writing is doing the work. What saves my life is never, you know, what gets picked, right, or produced, or, you know, published, or whatever it is, or, you know, any of the success or criticism that comes after. You know, what saves my life is doing the work. And that's, you know, that's what I would tell my younger writer self, that as long as you're doing the work, you're going to be okay emotionally, you know, financially, marry a dentist, but that's something I should have done. But emotionally, you're going to be okay if you're doing the work.
Alyson.
I mean, mine also probably sadly comes from a similar, I went from like being background to male partners for a long time to then being like, okay, I would finally show them what I was doing, but I would do this thing where I'd say, I'd only want to hear you like it. I'm giving it to you. You like it. Now, what are the things that you would think I could do to make this funnier? Because I was so beholden to them owning what was funny and me feeling very insecure around my own comedy to then finally like not even bothering to show it to them and not even needing their approval at all. But like that was like a 25 year journey. So I would just probably have started off. I mean, maybe it was one I had to go through, but you know, I think trusting my own comedic sense earlier. I think it took me a really long time to do that.
And I agree with everything you guys are saying. God, thank God I didn't get married in my 20s. I'm a completely different person now. Still not married, like still not ready for that. But thank you so much for coming on the show and congratulations. We've got the last episode of Teenage Euthanasia, September 27th of season 2. And hopefully it's not the last episode ever. I want many, many seasons. I want to see Euthanasia grow up and become a mother herself. All that good stuff. Alissa, Alyson, thank you for coming on the show. This is where I leave you. Everyone else, we'll see you next time on Right On.
Thanks again to Alyson and Alissa for coming on the show. You can watch Teenage Euthanasia on Cartoon Network right now.
And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Sharday Sellers. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.